Good afternoon and good morning, wherever you are in the art world. Today, the Art Talks are delighted to have Boris Magrini from the HEK in Art in Basel. So, Boris, thank you so much for being with us tonight. How are you?
I'm very good, thank you. Thank you for hosting me.
Thank you. Thank you for you to take some time and a lot of patience, because today the Art Talks are in a very special location in the metaverse, with this, in a project that actually you are organizing. So can you, before we go into this, Boris, could you tell us a bit the vision, the HEK's vision and mission?
Yes, well, HEK is a house of electronic arts. It's a museum and an institution in Basel, in Switzerland, founded in 11 years ago, which is dedicated to promoting digital culture and electronic arts in different forms, electronic art that uses electronic media, digital media, but also who, that reflects on these technologies. We are presenting exhibition, temporary exhibition with contemporary artists, but we also have a collection of more than 70 works, mainly digitally based works, artworks, that we also take care of collecting, of conserving, restoring sometimes, and distributing. There is also sometimes other institutions that ask us to rent some of our works. And of course, we also have a program of conference, of lectures, artist talks. We have an educational department. We propose workshops for children, for families, but also for adults, sometimes also topics related to art and technology. We also host concerts of electronic music and sometimes also performance. So we try to cover not only the visual arts, but the whole spectrum of the cultural production related to new technology, digital technologies, electronic arts. For us, it is not only the medium that is important. For us, it's really the discourse about these technologies and this medium. We favor artists that use this technology, but also artists who reflect and also critically reflect sometimes on these technologies. And so this is the reason also why we have very often group shows on topic like artificial intelligence, for example, technology and ecology. We had an exhibition on big data, surveillance capitalism, for example. And the upcoming exhibition that we are opening in 1 week, it's about Web3 and the metaverse.
Fantastic. So the thing is, you're also you curate so many exhibitions, especially to promote transdisciplinary dialogue between the arts and the sciences. Which one is one of your most favorite exhibition that, you know, is still in your heart?
Well, it's really difficult to say. It's a bit like when somebody asks you, what is your favorite artist or what's your favorite movie? I used to be sure about that when I was younger. Now, the more I grow old, the less sure I have an answer. For sure, I can mention a couple of them. For sure, one of the latest exhibition I curated at HEK was Radical Gaming, which was a selection of artists producing real video games, but of course, not commercial ones, but video games as art form. And it was interesting to see how this technology, also the fact that to produce video games nowadays has become more accessible. And it was interesting to see how artists were able to create video games that really challenges some of our stereotypes. Huh? There were artists using video games to discuss topics related to gender question. There were artists creating video games that were more aesthetic and even challenging the usual gameplay, the usual game mechanics that we find in commercial video games, tackle some political questions as well, social political questions. So that for sure was an exhibition that I cherish very much. But there are many others. For example, together with Sabine Himmelsbach, we co-curated a show in Luxembourg, because last year it was the European Capital of Culture, so we were invited to create an exhibition on the topic of ecology and technology. And that was also a big event, because it was a really a huge industrial hall and with a lot of surfaces, but also quite challenging to occupy. And we created the exhibition Earthbound together. That was also for me a very important moment, I would say. There are so many others that come to my mind. We also, maybe if I can mention just something we had during the pandemic, we started also an online program of works. We invited artists to create some intervention that happened only in the online space. Like they took over, for example, our social networks to create works and stories, or the Hector website, and so on and so on. That was also a very inspiring moment to go back almost to the roots of net art from the 90s and see what the artists are doing today as well in this long tradition that now exists since almost 30 years.
Boris, one thing that you mentioned, it's about putting together art, science, technology, which are more and more interconnected to each other, especially after what we went through the pandemic. We actually had the talk on some artists and scientists that wanted to, you know, to show, try to bridge this world, art and science. In fact, as you mentioned, artists are trying more and more to use all these technologies to talk about the current thematic environment and isolation, time, life. But, you know, do you think really art can really push the limitations of science into the realm of imagination?
It's a very fascinating question, but also a bit a tricky one. I published a book called Confronting the Machine, and that was, a bit my introductory point to the topic of media art, where I traced a bit the history of the use of artificial intelligence in art. And also I question a bit exactly this narrative, because very often when we hear about this project of art and science, we hear again and again this idea that arts can bridge the gap between the humanities and the science, and arts can bring the science closer to the population. And I think there's a lot of truth in this, but there's also a lot of stereotypes. Like art is exciting and beautiful, science is difficult and unapproachable. Art can make science more beautiful and more easy and more colorful. I think we have to be a bit careful. I think, first of all, I don't think it is the role of the arts to bridge the gap between the population and the science. I think the beauty of art is precisely the fact that artists don't have to fulfill a role. They don't have to do something that we expect them to do. And very often they excel exactly when they do something that we do not expect them to do. And that's something very precious that I want the arts to keep keeping this freedom they have. And on the other hand, I think also the science has extremely fascinating on their own. It's almost a bit insulting to say that the arts needs the science need the arts in order to be poetic and beautiful and interesting. On the other hand, it is true that the collaboration that we have seen and that have been also fostered by a lot of programs that have been developed in many countries now, like artists in residence in labs. Cross collaboration, cross production, and so on. I think they are necessary. I think they are absolutely fascinating. I think very often the product that people expect from this collaboration between the art and the science might often be disappointing in one way, because we have really two different languages sometimes and two different expectations. But I think sometimes it is useful. And I think where the arts are important, it's not about making the science more accessible or more beautiful or more poetic. I think the arts, when they approach topic related to science, they allow to give a different angle to the subject. They allow to see some ramification of some scientific research that the scientists don't deal with, not because they don't see it, not because they are stupid or they are not creative, because it's not their it's not their job to go into those ramifications that the artists have the freedom to go to. And I think that is what is interesting. And I think that is what is necessary, because very often the artists bring some perspective. We have seen, for example, with the question very, very recent of the bias of the algorithms. When we talk about artificial intelligence, this is a topic that has been discussed in the last years many, many times. How artificial intelligence needs to be trained, especially machine learning, needs to be trained with database, and these databases are subject to stereotypes and also to, of course, some bias. And this is a topic that very often the scientists, they deal with, of course, but they are also focusing on solution, on focusing on providing real concrete solution, how to create these systems. And the arts and the humanities can tackle this problem and show this problem in a constructive and in a poetic way that might not be so maybe so rigorous scientifically. We have seen some artists playing out with this question of the bias, but they allow a discussion that is necessary, that goes beyond the circle of the scientists and brings this discussion to the population, to the politics, to politicians and lawmakers. And I think this is an important role indeed.
And there's you know, one of our I'm paraphrasing Joteva, which was a Bulgarian, she's a Bulgarian intermediate artist and researcher in based in LA. She was saying that, you know, really art can help scientists consider more holistic and mysterious perspective beyond the specialized disciplines. So exactly what you were saying. But it's amazing. And your book, where can we read it? Is it?
You can find it online. You can find it in libraries. It's been published by De Gruyter. It was 2017.
Already? Wow, you were pre-visionario.
Well, what happened? It's funny because when I started researching artificial intelligence and art, it was in 2010, everybody was telling me that it's an old topic, nobody's interested in it anymore. Because it's true, artificial intelligence started in the 50s, and then there were some peaks in the 70s and in the 80s. And in 2010, it was not trendy anymore. It was an old topic. But then with the machine learning advances that we had in 2015, 16, then it became interesting. And that's why as we made an exhibition at HEK, Entangled Realities, which was also an exhibition about these new GANs and machine learning technology. We presented this exhibition at HEK, and now we see it's really also with the new Stable Diffusion, Midjourney, DALL-E, and so on. We have really ChatGPT. We have some advances that are really impressive, I must say. Of course, in the end, those are large system trained with data set. There's no consciousness. We are far away from the science fiction scenario of the good old-fashioned, all-encompassing artificial intelligence. But the results are quite impressive. And I think it's challenging. It's challenging also for the artists. It's challenging for creativity. It's exciting on the other hand as well.
Yes. No, I think it's an incredible moment. You know that there's so many things that we can do. But we have to, of course, in anything we do, I think, use common sense, because that's very important. But one thing,
who decides what is the common sense? That is a good question.
I know you're right. But how is your, let's say, your public, your audience, how is engaged with your exhibitions?
A very positive response. Very often we have a very varied public that comes to HEK. We also have some feedback questionnaires that we have that people can use to also give feedback, and we are always very much interested to see the question that they ask about the exhibition, how they respond. They come to our talks as well. They come to our educational program, and I think I can say that I see a lot of interest in this question. I see that the people are really interested in being challenged. They are interested in seeing exhibition that stimulates them, that raise some question. And that's why also we often try to avoid like black and white scenarios. You know, if we do an exhibition on blockchain or on Web3, We want to acknowledge these technologies. We want to acknowledge the significance for the society of this technology. But we also want to invite artists to discuss maybe also some weakness or some problems related to this technology. And we always try to have a kind of a variety group of arguments, a variety points of view in our exhibition.
So now a more specific question to your next exhibition that you're having, which is DAOs, decentralized autonomous organizations, are viewed by many as the foundation of a more democratic metaverse, perhaps even in real life via blockchain. Can you tell us more about your latest exhibition and how DAOs, metaverse and Web3 converge?
Yes, so the next exhibition opening in 1 week, it's collective world building, art in the metaverse. Of course, those are also a little bit buzzwords. The term metaverse, which the definition itself, it's very fluid. We heard this word from many different companies. It is a virtual space. It is a space that also maybe relates more deeply than the cyberspace to real life, also to the economy of real life. And this is why it's very much related to Web3. Web3, not to be confused with the Web 3.0, which is another another idea. But the Web3, it's basically the web that integrates blockchain technologies and wallets for an economy that it's based on cryptocurrencies. And it's true that many metaverse today, so-called metaverse, they integrate wallets and Web3 technologies. We think it's interesting. We think it's something that it's worth exploring. DAOs, decentralized autonomous organization, are allowed precisely by blockchain, because the blockchain allow for the creation of smart contracts that allow the organization to be autonomous. That means also decentralized. I mean, you can create an organization where the rules are written on blockchain, and these rules are functioning once you program them, without the need of having a central authority who organizes it. And so you can have an autonomous and decentralized organization. And we have seen the proliferation of a lot of such organization for different reasons. So we have DAOs that deal with mainly also with fundings, but also fundings for humanitarian reason, for example. We have DAOs that are more cultural, more related to creating events and so on. And in our exhibition, we invite artists that approach these topics. So we have invited artists that have created their own DAOs for creative or poetic purpose. We have artists that explore some of the metaverse, like VR chat, for example, is a very famous one. It's a virtual reality world on Steam. Other artists have more questioned the economics behind the Web3 and the speculation around the metaverse. And so we have, again, a variety of different artists in the exhibition that tackles all this question. For us, it was interesting, especially to put a focus on the collaborative experience, whether it's DAOs, whether it's metaverse, whether it's Web3. All this technology allow for collaboration, for exchange. It's about community. It's about questioning together this technology. And this is for us what is exciting to explore.
But can you tell me again, you know, how did you choose your artist for this exhibition? But what do, are you looking for?
But very often, so again, this is an exhibition we have co-curated, me and Sabine. And very often we start long ago, I would say more than 1 year ago, we start to prospect, we start to read about the topic, we start to read theory and articles to understand what are the key questions that we want to tackle, which angle we want to give. And then when we have this theoretical framework, we can start to prospect artists. So we keep the eyes open, we go to see exhibition, we take notes, we collect names, we collect works, and then we start to see in which direction, which one we want to keep, which one are interesting. And of course, we are also very careful to have a variety of arts from different nationalities, different genres. And at the end, we come with a selection of more or less often 15 artists, because that's also the space that we have. We have about 500 square meters of exhibition space. So we generally, we think that a pool of 15 artists is quite representative for a group show. And it's what our space also can host in a comfortable way. So, but very often, yes, it's a question of prospecting to try to find as much as possible, as many artists as possible that relates to the topic, and then trying to come with a list that, in our opinion, is very subjective often, of course, but it's a question of which artist brings some interesting point of view on the topic that we want to approach. And us, of course, come with some aesthetic solutions that are maybe surprising or original. That is us, of course, we're talking about art. So also the formal aspects of the work is also relevant in some way.
Fantastic. And Boris, one more question. Do you already have something, you can share some of your next projects or it's going to be still in process?
Absolutely. So the next exhibition after collective world building, it's an exhibition about blockchain. So we consider it almost chapter two. So we have the first exhibition on the focusing on the metaverse and DAOs, and the second exhibition opening in September focus on blockchain and especially also the blockchain as a technology, also the economic impact blockchain has. And we present a selection of artists that really also conceptually work with the technology itself. So we have really two exhibitions that tackle the question of Web3 and decentralization in two different chapters, I would say. And this is the reason why also we are going to publish a catalog of both exhibitions together. But another exciting project that we are working on and we are going to announce very soon is that we are creating our own DAO as a circle of friends. And we will invite the people to join this DAO and to participate in some events. The people who will join this DAO will also have the possibility to vote on some of the artists to be exhibited in our virtual space online, for example. And this is for us also a way to reach a larger audience, also beyond maybe the geography and beyond the public that can reach us physically in Basel. But it's also a way for us to experiment really in our own with our own hands with this technology in a creative way, and also bring the discussion about it together, share this discussion about decentralization, about Web3. With the people who will join this DAO with us.
Wonderful, wow. So we are really looking forward to see again, so to book us ourselves for September. It's so exciting. I think it's very important, as you said, to connect, and this is all about connection, community, and people from different parts of the world in case they cannot join us, in Switzerland, to be part of this project. That's really fantastic. Boris, really looking forward to meeting you and all your team in a couple of weeks, actually, very soon.
Yes, absolutely. Looking forward to meet you too in Basel. And also very, very excited to open this exhibition, and I hope everyone will come. Everybody's welcome to join us for the opening and for the next months that is presented at HEK.
Yes, and the last thing that I need to explain, my wonderful picture. This is one part of your exhibition, because today, thanks to technology, I had to stop in doing the art talk in a different scenografia, as we can say. But can you tell us a bit about this artist?
Well, you are in the metaverse right now, so this
I'm in the metaverse,
and not only in the metaverse, but you are in the underwater laboratory created by Korean artist Ayoung Kim. This is the Surisol underwater laboratory. So it's actually in VR chat. We were talking about VR chat. VR chat is really one of the most famous, I would say, and populated virtual reality world today. And Ayun Kim created this laboratory underwater, so you can visit it through VR, but also through a desktop. And it is a fictional work. It's a fictional laboratory, but that approaches through this fiction question related to production of algae, ecology, quality of life, quality of nutrition. So it is a fictional work, but it is also a philosophical one, I would say.
Bellissimo, bellissimo. So you know, it is really an honor to be in this metaverse, and again, looking forward to be in the HEK metaverse very soon in real life. Okay, grazie, Boris. Really wonderful to have you with us.
Thank you so much.
Have a wonderful evening, and ciao, bye.
And you too, and I see you at HEK.
Grazie, ciao, bye.
Bye-bye.